And can you take out this slide and wait for a few minutes before I introduce it? Good afternoon, all of you. When Uri Heiniger asked me to contribute to a session on forgotten wisdom, the most influential trial you need to have heard of, it took me a split second to accept his invitation, since it provided me with the opportunity to communicate that trials in itself are not the source of wisdom that have influenced my career as a clinical scientist. So, Uri, I will be the anarchist in this session and not discuss a forgotten trial. I will instead discuss a set of papers from 2 decades ago, their importance for pediatric infectious diseases community, and I aim to stimulate all of you to read more papers from a gifted teacher and clinical scientist who is the first author of those papers. Arturo Casadevos, Professor of Molecular Microbiology and Infectious Diseases at the Johns Hopkins School of Medicine, and a wonderful conceptual thinker. Conceptual thinking is the ability to see the big picture and get a better understanding of the context, and at the same time to understand how things are associated and connected to identify systems at play and their relationships. In this slide, you see one of a large number of thought-provoking papers of Casadevall with the title Historical Science, which allows me to congratulate the choice of the Swiss organizers of SP2021 to focus on wisdom of the past, which, as you can see, is completely in agreement with the way of thinking of Casadevall. As quoted here, a better understanding of history can illuminate social influences on the scientific process, allow scientists to learn from previous errors, and provide a greater appreciation of the importance of serendipity in scientific discovery. History can indeed make science better. Another example of creative thinking by Casadevall is illustrated on this slide and refers to the cause of extinction of the dinosaurs 65 million years ago due to the impact of a huge meteorite, followed by an ecological calamity, massive deforestation, and a fungal bloom as the earth became a massive compost. Casadevall convincingly argues in 2 papers that fungal diseases have contributed to the demise of the dinosaurs. Fungal diseases are possibly more important for clinical practice than many of us think, and I'm therefore very happy that a splendid Bill Marshall lecture this year was yesterday given by Adelia Warris, who is similar to Casadevall, a deep interest in fungal pathogenesis. Before showing the next slide with the paper from Casadevall selected by me, I would propose that Casadevall provides in this paper a scientific rationale that you cannot be an expert in infectious diseases without an in-depth understanding of the host response and of immunology. My British colleagues have realized this many years ago, as reflected by the name of their society, British Pediatric Infection and Immunology Group. Unfortunately, their example is not broadly followed on the continent. The BPIAG is standing on the shoulders of another innovator in pediatric infectious diseases, Professor Richard Moxon, who was, and this is not a coincidence, similar to Casadevall, specialized in molecular microbiology and infectious diseases with an in-depth knowledge of the host response to microbes and vaccines. In the late 20th century, we started to diagnose multiple new infectious diseases that were caused by microorganisms, which are not normally seen in immunocompetent hosts. This raised the awareness that the old concepts of pathogenicity and virulence were inadequate, and was the reason for Casadevall and Pirovsky to develop a new model to understand microbial pathogenesis. This concept is based on 3 tenets. First, microbial pathogenesis is the outcome of an interaction between a host and a microorganism. Second, the host relevant outcome of this interaction is determined by the amount of damage to the host. And third, host damage can result from microbial factors and or host response. On this slide from the paper in Nature Reviews in Microbiology, you see the basic parabolic curve of the damage host response framework. which provides a model to understand microbial pathogenesis. The arrow indicates the position of the curve is variable and depends on the particular host microorganism interaction. The y-axis shows host damage as a function of the host response. Weak and strong immune responses both refer to qualitative and quantitative characteristics of the host response. In this example of a microbial host interaction, host damage is magnified both in the presence of a weak and of a strong response. In case of commensalism, the relationship is mutually beneficial for host and microorganism. In situations of colonization, damage may be minimal, but is there. In situations with latency, for example, granuloma formation by tuberculosis, organ and cellular damage will be present. In the initial papers on the damage response framework, six classes of pathogens were described. Pathogens inducing damage only in the presence of a weak immune response, and you see examples here. Pathogens who induce damage in the presence of a weak or a normal immune response. Pathogens who induce damage in the presence of an appropriate immune response and at both ends of the spectrum. Pathogens who induce damage across the spectrum, but damage can be enhanced by a strong immune response. And pathogens who induce damage only in the presence of a strong immune response. Examples of microorganisms associated with one of these curves are shown here. These curves also offer a model to reflect, for example, about the pathogenesis of infections caused by SARS-CoV-2. Do they follow a pattern similar to histoplasmosis, with a risk for increased damage in patients with a low immune response, or underlying pulmonary diseases, but also possibly an exaggerated immune response resulting in a post-COVID condition in previously healthy patients? These are the microbial response curves of the six classes in the previous slide with examples of microorganisms. Pneumocystis, carinii, or Yersinia is well known since the AIDS epidemic. Strep pneumoniae, frequently seen in immunodeficient patients, but also in the presence of a normal immune response. Histoplasmosis, frequently diagnosed in immunodeficient patients, but also involved in a prolonged inflammatory syndrome called chronic pulmonary histoplasmosis. Aspergillus is the major pathogen in patients under chemotherapy or transplantation, but also in patients with cystic fibrosis, as you heard yesterday, in an exaggerated immune-mediated disease called allergic aspergillosis. GI tract infections by Campylobacter species are common in persons with normal immune system, but Campylobacter is also involved in the pathogenesis of the Guillain-Barré syndrome. In the paper in reviews in microbiology, Kasadevall updated the six classes with three other classes. Example B, shown on this slide, shows a situation where a microbial factor, for example, a toxin, works so quickly that the immune system has no time to respond. The example C and D refer to theoretical situations caused by possible new microorganisms in the future. Microbial damage, as you can see here, can be at the molecular level, the cellular level, the tissue level, organ level, or at a behavioral level, as indicated here. Examples of microbes that induce different types of damage are presented in the paper. Also shown on the bottom of this slide is an example of a damage response curve in which host damage caused by Mycobacterium tuberculosis is plotted as a function of time. The conclusion of the paper by Kasadevall are that microbial pathogenesis is the outcome of an interaction between host and microorganism. Two, the host relevant outcome of this interaction is determined by the amount of damage to the host. Three, host damage can result from microbial factors and or the host response. As shown in the table, the outcome can be either or not of benefit to the host or to the microorganism. I added for your information on the bottom a paper from Kasadevall from 2015 in which microbiota are incorporated in the damage response network. Slide out, please. You may ask me why I selected this paper. The answer is that the model proposed by Casadevo clarifies more than anything else the close relationship between pediatric immunology and immunogenetics on one hand, and pediatric infectious diseases and microbiology on the other hand. The model is also a wonderful educational tool to teach students about infectious diseases and the host response. Casadevo has written many more challenging papers, which you will be able to find on an additional slide. To finish with a quote from Casadevo, bring philosophy, PH, back into PhD. Thank you.